lately. But I promise I will get them up there eventually. So basically what we do is we just take turns sharing our screen, showing off our find from the past week. We ask that everyone try to limit themselves to 3 to 5 items that they're showing, or keep it to like, you know, 5-7 minutes so everyone gets a chance to share. And we also asked if somebody could volunteer to type the names into the chat so everyone can follow along. I can't really type the names in if I'm sharing the screen. So I do have stuff that people sent me. I'll ask now too, before we start that, if there's other people who have stuff that they want to share from their own screens, if you would type your name into the chat box and I'll get a queue going for that. Or does anybody just want to jump right in right now and get started? I also muted everybody, so you have to unmute yourself to talk.
I guess I could start.
Okay, well, do you want me to share your stuff, Dorothy, or do you want to share it?
Oh, no, you have to do it.
Oh, right. Okay, I'll get that.
And 2 emails.
Okay. Yep. All right, I'll start there. That sounds good.
But I'll be fast.
All right, well. I only have stuff from maybe 4 or 5 people. So if nobody else is speaking up to say they have stuff to share, I certainly won't rush anybody through this. I'll just let people take their time. It's only when I start getting a big list of people, or, you know, there's 10 people in line that want to share, that's when I start, you know, trying to push people along. Okay, so here's your first email, Dorothy.
Okay. So just the other day, you know, after all the rain we had, everybody kind of knows this, Gymnosporangium juniperi virginiane, and all that orange slimy stuff it's actually a cedar apple rust. So this is growing from this brown thing with holes in all the spores in this gelatinous mass come out of these holes. It's on a red cedar juniper. And the alternate host for this rust disease is anything in the apple family, including, apple trees and other fruit trees that are in that family, the Rosaceae, but also Amelanchier. And I made the mistake of planting a shad bush, which is the genus Amelanchier, next to a red cedar juniper in my yard. And so the first time I got flowers and then fruit, they were all covered with the rust disease. So you have 2 hosts in this life cycle. And rusts, by the way, are basidiomycota. So the other thing I found this week, and this is the underside. So you see these beautiful, almost diamond-shaped pores, and it was growing from wood, the top side is the next picture, kind of has a dimple in the middle. This is what they call winter polypore, Polyporus brumalis, if that name hasn't changed, I don't know. But it is found in the spring. So it was very fresh when I did find it. So that's the only mushroomy type thing that I have. But just today I was walking along my street. And so there's 2 other pictures that I need to see from the last one, Luke.
Oh, sorry.
As I was walking along the street, I noticed on this slippery elm, all of these galls coming from the leaf. Now, these particular galls are growths that can be caused by genetics, they can be caused by a virus, they can be caused by bacteria, insects, and fungi. So these particular growths I thought were pretty interesting looking and red. So the next picture shows them from a side view. And I had no idea what they were. I put them on iNaturalist and immediately it came up that these were the elm sack gall aphid caused by a little aphid insect. And it even has a stalk. So this was a slippery elm tree. And I thought, different galls. Well, I was down in the lichen foray. So now, thank you, Luke, you could switch to the others. I was down in the lichen foray and we did see something funny on the next picture. And I need to go backwards. I'm sorry I didn't put these in order. I did see something like this. And it's on blueberry. Of course, the Pine Barrens where we were for the lichen foray is just covered with blueberries. And this is a stem, blueberry stem gall. And this is caused also by an insect, a small wasp. Sometimes it's called a kidney gall. And it can form a lot on high bush blueberry. But I remember, and now if you can go back to where you were, I remember years ago when I was down in the Pine Barrens and I was walking with Dr. Gene Varney, a former president of our club. And he said, what we saw was this white growth on the leaf of blueberry, also grows on azaleas and which is what this is on, azaleas and camellia. And the genus is actually Exobasidium, which is another fungus caused gall, Basidiomycota. Sometimes it's this white spongy thing, and sometimes it can be pink or yellow. And there's actually a disease of tea, which is the genus Camellia, that's an Exobasidium. So this is Exobasidium vaccinii.
Dorothy?
Yes.
May I interrupt you? Okay. So there are like 70 Exobasidium species, and you have to do the micro to set up the difference between Exobasidium vaccini and Exobasidium rhododendron. Rhododendron okay. has a bigger basidia.
All right. This picture that I did not take, this is from online. So yes. I assume it was correct.
I only say it because I found it and I was very confused because all I can find is identify it as Exobasidium vaccini, but it's not on blueberry. And this basidia doesn't correspond to the basidia size of vaccini, but to the basidia size of Exobasidium rhododendron. That's what I'm trying to tell you. So micro
all
is-
All right, this picture, which was labeled Exobasidium vaccinii, occurs on, it's the azalea gall, but azalea, the genus is rhododendron. So, you know, I'm just going from a Cornell University info page and this picture. So I'm sure you have to go to the microscope to figure these out, but that's not my point, Maricel. What okay. I was just talking about was how it's fun to see galls, whether they're caused by insect or fungi or otherwise. So just if you-
Oh, I see, yes, gotcha. Yeah,
that's my point. It wasn't specifically for an ID situation. And then if we go to my last picture. This is a rust disease of blueberry leaves that according to, I didn't take this picture, it's online. it's Neohidomyces vaccinia. And all these little spots are caused by a fungus. But there's so many rust diseases, and the cedar apple rust is that particular gall thing that I showed earlier with the orange slime. It is also a rust disease. So I just, you know, if you're looking for mushrooms and walking in the woods, you might see some of these crazy galls, and the insect caused ones are fascinating to try to figure out what's causing them. So anyway, that's what I thought would be interesting, since there's not too much out in the way of fleshy fungi. That's all. Thanks, Luke.
Thanks, Dorothy. I have a question. These here, this Exopisidium, so that's strictly fungal. There's no insect association at all with them?
Right. Okay. And this happens to be, I believe, this looks like that beautiful orange azalea rhododendron species that blooms in the Carolinas. It's actually pollinated by tiger swallowtail butterflies, because the female and male parts are so far away, it's the butterfly flapping wings that causes the pollination. That's cool. A fascinating thing online that I found.
All right. Before we go away from your galls, check out this website. I won't go into it too much. It's called gallformers.org. There's the address up there. And it actually is a resource for identifying galls. I haven't really gotten to explore it too much. I just found it just recently. But if you're into galls, this might be a good place to hang out. All right. So thanks, Dorothy.
Thanks, Luke.
Sure. Okay. So I think I'm just going to go in order now, the way I got them sent to me. So are you there, Dave?
Yeah. You can skip the first one. It occurred to me today that I showed that last week.
Okay, so go right to here.
Yeah. It's a couple of small things I found on my property. A small mushroom with a really big name. Rhizomarasmius pyrocephalus. Pretty common. Grows in leaf litter and on twigs and stuff. Usually hardwood, I guess. It's pretty easy to identify, actually, for a little mushroom. White spored. It's got a long stipe that doesn't quite root, but it goes into the substrate, like leaf litter. It goes between leaves. And pyrocephalus means firehead.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of times it's more orangey than these pale yellow ones. Maybe because it was coming out off of a lot of rain over 3 days, maybe they were not quite as orange as they might be otherwise. So I find these in the spring, and then I find them again in the fall, and they're one of the first gilled mushrooms to appear and one of the last gilled mushrooms to hang around, sometimes into December. So, and they're not like a mulch mushroom either. They're a forest mushroom, unlike leaf litter, stuff like that. So, you know, not the most exciting thing in the world, but you know, it's something. The spores are, well, there they are. I guess up to around 10 microns long, 7 to 10. 3 to 4, I think, is what I measured, what I estimated here.
That's the name, pyrocephalus?
Yes.
There you go.
Yeah, that's the species name.
Pyrocephalus. It used to be the genus Marasmius.
Yeah.
And
it used to what's be the species?
And when Ray Fatto pointed it out to me, you know, he was showing me the cystidia, which have this very interesting shape.
Riesel.
Oh, that's right. You know what? I forgot to do that. I should have probably tried to scope some gill. That's right. These guys have some kind of weird cystidia. I forget. But, yeah, maybe I'll get a few more and do that because they're out in my yard now.
What habitat?
Leaf litter.
Okay.
Hardwood.
You had to dig or you saw the caps?
No, the caps stick out above the leaf litter, but you see the dark parts of the stem?
Yeah, that's deep.
Most of that is immersed in the substrate.
Okay.
And the very, very bottom you can see has dirt on it, soil. Mm-hmm. And that part's sort of in the ground. But yeah, you can see them. I think one of the photos, I'm not sure which photos I include. Oh, I think I left it out. There's actually one photo where I just showed one single cap sticking out. I think the first photo shows one or two fruit bodies in situ. Yeah, there we go. See the two of them, the left and the right, upper left, lower right. Yep. Those were not posed. That's the way they looked.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you'll usually see.
Man, that's a big struggle to come out up.
Yeah.
Through that litter.
Yeah, it needs a long stem, really. Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm gonna go get some more of these. Maybe I'll even run out tonight. I just go right out my door and I can get some. Maybe I'll try to find some of those cystidia. Yeah, it's a fun thing to find.
What's the is that the spelling?
I think I got it right.
I'm not sure that I am right.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Y and H. Okay, thanks.
It does mean fire.
Yeah.
Firehead.
Yep. So I don't know. Do other people find this species to be as common as I do?
Yeah, I found it a lot.
Yeah,
even here in New Jersey.
Yeah, it's a lawn mushroom, a field mushroom.
Well,
it's small.
Well, leaf litter more on the edge of the woods or in the woods.
Oh really? I find it mostly on lawns.
I was gonna say in Philadelphia. I think it's common in Philadelphia in lawns, like I'll find it like on the strips along the sidewalks.
I find it in parks.
Talking about.
I'll say it looks just like the same kind of grassy stuff that you have right there. Same kind of mixture of grass.
That's in my yard. I find that every year they come up in my yard, not always exactly the same place. It moves around a little.
This is an agrosipe.
Agrosipe, yeah. Yes, it's small for agrosipe. There's a few other small agrosipes. Usually when you think of agrosipe, you think of a pretty big fleshy mushroom, but these guys are
small. Unless it's Pediades.
Oh, is that how you say it?
Oh, I didn't know you switched to that. I thought you were talking about the Pyromorosmius. I mean,
I call it Pediades. I probably am saying it the wrong way.
We did switch to a new mushroom, agrosipe pediate. Pediades.
Pediades or Pediades. How did you say it, Dorothy?
Well, the way I think I've heard it is aggressively Pediades.
Pediades. Wow.
It could be, yeah.
I don't know. This sounds like a tomato kind of thing to me. I'm not going to probably remember that. Because I've been saying Pediades, you know, for many, many years. It's got pretty cool spores. They're big. These little guys have big spores. These are actually small. This example has fairly small spores, only up to about, what did I say? They're up to 15. They get even bigger than that. And so up to about 18 microns, according to most sources. And they also, they have the usual agrosipe type cystidia, sort of fat on the bottom with a little head or a little neck sort of thing. I got some agrosipe today that I'm pretty sure is agrosipe praecox. I didn't get the observation made yet, but the pictures are still in my camera. And that has cystidia that look a little different than this, but not all that different. So sort of fat and rounded on the bottom and a little apical sort of a neck or a, almost like a head. So.
Are there any agrostomy that anybody eats?
No, I think they all taste lousy is from what I understand. Oh, wait, no. Cyclocybe, which is basically an offshoot of agrostomy. There's one that's cultivated in Europe, and it's been found in South Central PA. There's a guy I know in Louisiana who finds it all the time. Cyclocybe, I forget the species name. I think the Italians call it Popa something. Popa, P-O-P-S.
Oh yeah, I know what you're talking about.
It's cultivated, but it grows in the wild also. There's two different names. Argenta, I think, is the one name. Cyclocybe argenta. And I'm bringing up cyclocybe, even though we're talking about agrostomy, because cyclocybe is basically a split off from genus agrostomy. Cyclocybe mushrooms used to be agrostomies. So, and they're morphologically pretty similar. I'm not sure about the cystidia on cyclocybe. The spores are a little different. Not that different though. Same color spore print too, kind of cigar brown.
Yeah, Peopenes are cyclocybe aegerita.
Aegerita, yeah. Okay. Yeah, there's another name that's used also, and it's a, who knows. I sent some to Stephen Russell because a guy in Louisiana kept finding them, and he actually sent some to me. And I looked at the spores for him. And so we had it pretty well narrowed down to these two species names. And the two species names might actually refer to the same taxon. I'm not convinced one way or the other, really. But I sent them to Stephen, but he hasn't done anything with them as far as I know. I find these every year. And, you know, these are pretty persistent seasonally, you know. You'll find them in the summer, you find them in the fall, you find them late in the season. They're kind of like Panaeolus phoenicecii. They start around the same time. You know, they're not related, but same kind of habitat, and they come and go throughout the year. So not the most exciting mushroom in the world, but, you know, it's if anything, it's just something to, you know, practice your microscopy skills. And the continuing saga of Mitrula. I went to a spot where I wanted to see if what they were going to be Mitrula elegans or Mitrula lunulatispora. These are elegans, and it's a similar habitat to my other elegans spot. It's conifer dominated. There's hardwoods present, and I collected a lot of them. I went to like three different patches and collected a bunch of these. Some of them were stuck to hemlock needles, or I'm sorry, hemlock twigs. Some were attached to leaf litter, like oak leaves. One was even attached with, there were a couple of them coming out of white pine cones. There's actually a picture coming up of them coming out of white pine cones. And I looked at spores from like four or five different fruit bodies. And in particular, I purposely looked at spores from one of the fruit bodies that was attached to a leaf, like maybe one of these two in this picture. You can see a leaf there, and the spores all look like cucumbers. There's no none of the spores have that boat shape or crescent moon shape. They all look like this. So if anything, this spore picture is a little better than the one I showed last week. There's an ascus. This does not have that weird pinched apex that Maricel's lunulatispora had that she showed last week. And Maricel might want to jump in here because she sent me an email. She sent an email to Scott Redhead, and he expressed some surprise, uh, a about this weird microscopic trait that she found in her Lunulatospora. I have a spot where Lunulatospora grows. It's just a little bit out of the way. I'm going to try to make it there this week before these guys disappear, if they haven't already, and try to look at some Lunulatospora. But see, this is a white pine cone, and they're growing right out of the cone.
Oh, yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah, that's weird, isn't it? And the one in the upper right, on the upper left, is coming out of a leaf. And I purposely scoped spores out of those different fruit bodies coming out of a different kind of substrate. And they all have the cucumber-shaped spores. So these are all Mitrilla elegans. So, and as we discussed last week, if you find Mitrilla lunulatospora, the color might be a tiny bit different, but they are apt to look pretty much just like these. So as Marisol said last week, you have to look at the spores to tell which one you have. Okay, so if I show some more Mitrilla next week, it'll be lunulatospora, hopefully.
I want to find elegans. All I find now is lunulatospora.
You need to find elegans.
Yeah, I went back and I took three samples from different spots in the same area, and they have the same defects, deformations.
They have that same weird ask. You have to wonder if that's not some sort of undocumented species.
Okay, so Mr.
Who knows, Redhead, you know?
Yeah, Mr. Redhead told me that it could be genetic, it could be environmental, it could be a viral infection. So the only thing that I can do is to keep an eye on it and see it. How often do I find the same characteristics in the?
Yeah, maybe you can preserve some of them.
I am. I started. Because
if it's genetic, then doesn't that imply that it could be a different species?
Yeah.
I mean, that's what genetic means.
Mm-hmm. So I have to find it within some period of time over and over with the same characteristics.
Right. Yeah. In order to establish
something different,
a novel species, you need some. You need to make several collections and hopefully in a few different places. Mm-hmm. But if you have it sequenced and there's some, you know, significant difference between the sequence and what is now on record for Lunulatospora, then that makes a pretty good case for saying it's something different. Mm-hmm. But who knows? From the Pine Barrens is like another planet as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah. He said that he cannot recall finding anything like that.
Right.
When he did the collections, but they did their collections in one place. Many specimens from one place. You know what I'm saying? So,
That's one reason why I want to get to my spot where I know Lunulatospora grows, because I want to bring some of those home and look at the ASCII and see if there if I can find any that have that same strange trait.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right, cool. Okay, I think thanks, that's Dave. All that I have this week.
Yep, that was it. Mm-hmm. All right, Susan, you're up.
Yeah. So this is week 10 of these sarcosomas, but I'm the next. Well, so anyway, I have two sequences here of the same fruiting bodies. This picture was taken on March 30th. Of the little snow melt fruiting body, okay? And then the next four pictures are of the same little cluster in the same spot, got a new little one underneath it. This one I think was, I didn't write down the dates, but about 2 weeks later. So this would have been about April 6 or 8. And then the next one, 2 weeks after that, Same. This is the same little fruiting bodies, okay? And then the next one is number 4, was about the 20th of May. And then the last one was taken today. Same little ones, what they look like.
Did it got eaten, or that's what the end?
Sorry?
Is that the end? That's how they look at the end?
Well, actually, they don't look beautiful anymore. So I will probably go in next week, but they're done. They're collapsed.
Oh.
Flat like an overflowing icing is when they're throwing their spores.
Now they're
collapsing. The water is kind of drying out of them. I found quite a few today that had slugs on them.
Yeah.
But they're done, basically. But they up entirely because it's been a little wet the last couple of days.
Mm-hmm.
So they're not totally shriveled up, all of them. Some of them are, some of them aren't. It's harder for me to see them because they blend in so well with the leaves.
How many weeks again was this?
This is the 10th week. One with the snow was taken on March 30th.
That's amazing.
I've actually taken a picture each week, but I weeded it out just to save you, you know, time. But this is about 2 weeks of the exact same little fruiting bodies. You can see the position of the pine cone and the little one underneath. Interesting that the little one underneath never really got very big, but developed sort of the same way, in that it sort of poofed up a little bit, and then it eventually just sort of, it's drying out in the center, sort of. I don't know if it ever even really made spores. And then I have the next email is a different group that's very close to this same group. I could recognize the same little groups by the order in which I go through the woods. And these were always the first group. Now this was, I think, taken about April 6 or 8. And unfortunately the light was such that I couldn't really get a really good shot, but you see the 1, 2, 3. I think I saw them, and here they are about 2 weeks later. They're starting to spread out and poof up a little bit, and nice rounded shape. And here they're starting to flatten out more and open out. And I don't think, they might be making spores here, but I think it's the next week after. But now they definitely are throwing their spores here. And they're almost done. And today they look really bad.
What's that? It
was too big a file, so I had to split the email. So this is what they look like now, those same three little mushrooms. I think that's really amazing.
I love this sequence.
Yeah.
I could actually probably put 10 pictures together, but you know,
she might be having some bandwidth problems.
Sequence with several mushrooms, and some of the ones that I wanted to do that with, somebody ate them along the way. So yeah. I couldn't continue the sequence.
Yeah.
When we had a dry couple of weeks, a number of them disappeared that I was particularly watching. And I'm sure the little red squirrels needed the moisture, so they ate them. And I think, is there one more picture here, Luke? I was helping a friend yesterday with
shiitake,
logs, and he was showing off his shiitake logs that he's been cultivating for about 10 years. Took a workshop that we did about 10 years ago, but I think these are oak logs that he inoculated about 18 months ago or 2 years ago. But he likes to sell them to the local restaurants, which is, you know, a little business up here. But I would be very pleased if I got that many shiitakes on one log.
Yeah, it looks nice.
Yeah. He let me pick a couple.
Awesome.
Good.
Is that good?
Nothing better. I tried to do that too. This is Bianca. I tried to do that too with my logs, and they're just blank and empty for now. This is the fourth year. There's just nothing.
No, they didn't take.
Yeah, well, I think Frank sort of puts them against a fence, and there's kind of a canoe over them, so they have a shelter from the wind, and, you know, he waters them if they need it, but he has a really good system or good luck in being able to grow a lot of things. But, you know, sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. That's all I have, though, Luke. Nothing up here.
Thanks, Joe.
Thank you.
Good do. Marisol, you're up.
Okay.
Maricel, are these things that you've seen this week?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
They're common names, crack me up.
I don't even know that it was the name on here.
Is that what Gary calls it? I don't think so.
No, this is iNaturalist. They make up a common name for everything.
Yeah, I know, but see that I don't like common names because they're not consistent.
No, we know. I'm laughing at it.
I know. That's what I'm saying. But I have found this mushroom. I like it.
There's your real name.
Oops. All right.
That's not you. Hang on.
It wasn't my observation. Okay. So on Saturday, I went to my ex's property, which is in the Pine Barrens, and it rained like holy moly. So I went outside with an umbrella and I collected mushrooms. So at the end, when I was almost done, I went to an area where he has a bird feeder and water for the birds. And I said, they don't have any seeds. So when I walked to put the seeds, to get the container to put the seeds, when I saw a stick on the ground with these red things, and I said, oh no, I found it. I never found it before. I knew what it was, but I never found it. It was on a stick, like a 1 foot long, kind of thin. And I put it in over the night on a slide, and the spore print is white. So you can pass. It's called Peniophora rufa. That's this part of the stick. The photos are so bad. It was gray and I couldn't do better than that. The spores. So it gave the spore print, which is white. I said that. The spores are beautiful. They're very long and narrow. I put the measurements in there, but I was curious to know what was special about it. So I got a good spore print, and then I tried to do the what other elements were inside, and it was so hard because this thing was like gelatinous. I couldn't do a better job. These are the basidia. One is a young one on the right, and one has 3 to 4 stigmata. Can you show the other photo? And it has a giant type of cystidia. I think it's gloeocystidia. But that was the best I could do. I couldn't have a clear picture. Yeah, that's all.
I just looked this up in Gary Linkoff's book, and he calls it the red tree brain.
Oh, there you go.
Oh, so that's his name.
he had to make up half the names for this book, you know, in the
audio. Yeah. Uh-huh. We heard about that. Yep.
So at least they're taking it from Gary's lead.
Oh, yeah. So the name that he used there.
It's very distinctive when you find it. I have found it twice up here, and I thought, holy crap, that's got to be something very distinctive.
And I don't really know too much about it, but I think it may have been growing above really high up on a tree because the branch was little and it just fell down. The branch seemed like dead, and by chance. And I look all around, I could not find anything else, just a little branch.
Now, I thought the opposite somewhat when I found it up here, in that the branches were already down, and this mm-hmm. was something that was colonizing it on more than one branch. And it's big.
I don't
and
know.
Some of them were very small.
Okay.
With sort of a first, what's that called, pioneer species or something, Dorothy, when it's one of the first things to invade a small branch?
I don't know. And it says that it happens on aspen trees, but I don't really know aspen trees. All I know is that there are a lot of poplars, unless poplar could be a type of an aspen, and maples. Those are the trees that are around the bird.
Yeah, aspens are in the poplar family.
Ah, so yeah, okay.
And that's probably what I found it on too.
Okay, so this area has a lot of poplars and maples. I never knew it with the name aspen, but poplars. Yeah, and it was pretty exciting. It's like a kind of a flat raisin like thing. And it's considered a crust fungus. That's very weird. Maybe because of the microscopic characters. I don't know.
Well, probably because of the genus, because most of the stuff in that genus are crust.
Yeah, it's a crust. Yeah.
Like most Peneophora are crust.
See, all the Peneophoras are crust. Right. I knew the name, yeah. Because all the other Peneophoras are flat, not like this. This is really something.
Right. You know, I was thinking you were talking about how you're having a hard time with microscopy. I remember Greg Thorne, who works with a lot of the jelly fungi, he told us that he usually dries any of his jelly stuff before he tries to cut it. He dries it, cuts it, and then rehydrates it.
Oh, I took it from fresh.
Yeah,
I came home and it was my first one to put my hands on it. Oof. Yeah, it was exciting. Yep.
The other thing I found about this is that when it dries up, you don't see it very well. And then it will rehydrate again, you know.
Yeah.
You get rain again and it'll stay out there for some time.
Mm-hmm.
It'll be somewhat recognizable.
It plumps up.
Cool find.
That was a good one. Whew. Okay, I heard before that there is something that grows on holly leaves. So I was near a holly tree and I went down to check the leaves and I found one with these speckles. And I remember maybe you have found it, Luke? No, you found a pulpo and something else, but I can't remember.
Yeah, I found a few things on holly trees, but not this, I don't think.
Oh, okay. So this one is so, so tiny. I couldn't do a better photo than that. And if you look at each thing, it's like a pimple with it bursts through the leaf surface, tap surface. So it makes like a kind of a mouth. I tried to do the micro, but it was impossible to get any info for what I did. I could not see anything clearly. When I get the sample from the inside this little pimple, there was a gelatinous matter, but I couldn't see the details. I saw a few weird spores, but I couldn't take photos. It wouldn't show. I just couldn't do it. But I found it in a book. I went through the whole book and I saw it's on the right host and it looks right. It's called the speckled something. It says there, holly speckled. Holly speckled. Mm-hmm. Hello?
Oh, yeah.
Easily missed.
What did you say?
Easily missed.
Yes. You have to bend down and really like look on all leaves.
Yep, hunt for that one.
Mm-hmm. This one was found in Winona Park, down in 295, Glassboro area. The name is Trochila ilicina. The tree is called Ilex, yeah?
Yes.
Ilex, yeah, ilicina, that makes sense, okay.
Okay, I was looking it up. There's another black speck that grows on holly called Phyllostitica. Phyllostitica leaf blotch.
Can you write the name so I can check on that one?
Yeah.
Please, thank you.
Because I remember finding some on that looks similar to this.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody gave me that name, but I couldn't do anything with the micro myself, so I never confirmed whether it was.
You writing it on the chat?
Yep, I sure am.
Okay.
There you go. Phyllostitica leaf blotch.
Phyllostitica leaf blotched. Phyllostitica. Okay, thanks.
In fact, you know what? When I'm done sharing, I have another thing that somebody sent me from like an extension about that.
Okay.
Such a long name for such a teeny tiny thing.
Complications of people. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Scutellina spot.
Okay. I'm so determined to find a Scutellina scutellata, but I haven't been lucky. So it is a Scutellina, but not a scutellata. but it was fun. I was very sort. This is in Winona too, in Winona Woods. No, Woods of Winona. And it was so huge. It was on the side of a hill, in a, the side of a cemetery. And it was growing on these vines that climb as a tree climbs. I don't know the name, but these vines are parasitic, not really parasitic. They use trees to go high, grow high. So when the tree grows, the vine is on the branches of the tree, so it keeps coming higher and higher. I don't know the name. So these escutelinias were a little different because the hairs were very short. I don't know if it is because they were so big. I measured them and I got three samples from three areas. I did the micro and they are the same. One had 1.25 millimeters long hair and these ones were 0.6 or 0.5 millimeter long. And when I did the micro, can you show the micro, please? Oh, the next. Okay. The hairs have thick walls. They have septa, which are the divisions inside for a structure, I guess, to make it like strong. And more, please. The base, I couldn't get a better photo than this, but the base of some of them is forked. This one has two parts. Other ones were simple, just not one base. Can you show the other things? And you can see the ascii and the paraphyses. The paraphyses are exerted beyond the ascii. Before the ascii goes out to eject the spores, I guess.
It looks like the immature ones.
Yeah. The mature ones are a little further out. Yeah.
Looks like artwork. That's a great.
Thought about that too. Yes.
Yeah, it does.
The colors. I use Floxine. So these ones are. You can see the ornamentation on the sides. It's like tuberculate, I will say, but it doesn't form a reticulation and it doesn't correspond to escutelinia. So I keep posting it in iNaturalist and this expert from England, he says, no, no escutelinia.
You don't think that's reticulation there?
No, that's inside. I'm going to show you the ornamentation in some photo. Okay, I can make it bigger than that.
So you can see the ornamentation.
Yeah. So that's the ornamentation, but that's all I can do. And as he told me, and I told you a week ago, it's a complex. So this might be a different escutelinia that we don't know. No name.
Who is the name of the guy in England?
Malcolm.
Malcolm.
I cannot remember the last name. I contact him through iNaturalist.
Greaves, isn't it? Malcolm Greaves.
I think so. Greaves.
Sounds right. Yeah.
Yeah.
He has quite a key for trying to sort them out, but mm-hmm, you.
Mm-hmm. He gave me the key, but I didn't have a chance to look at it.
Yeah.
And compare, yeah. But still, he says that it's a complex, so who knows how many scutellinia, scutellata varieties of different species we have. But it's fun to do the micro and see all these characters. I like it. Okay. And in the same area on the side of this woods of Winona, in the side of the cemetery, I went down to look for something that looked like a white crepidotus. And when I went down, my eyes saw something yellow. I said, oh no, I found it. And this is Coccomyces triangularis. I was so excited. And I just froze in there and I looked around me and I could not find any other branch that had these guys on. It was only one little stick, like a terminal tip of a very little branch. So these, okay, so these caps burst through the bark. And then can you come back to the caps for 1 second? Okay, so you can see that around the cap, there is a brown area. One is the bark that is split open for this thing to come out. Then can you show on the right side, the second one on the right? The second one towards the left. No, no. In the right side, one. No, go to the, that one in the center. Okay, you can see the bark in the lower right, and then you can see the brown, yeah? Oh, you can see it in the other one too, in the one in the left. So the brown is part of the cap, and it's made out of inflated structures that I show in the micro photo. You can show that one, please. Mm-hmm. This brown area surrounds the whole cap, goes even under the base. It's dark, and so these inflated shapes are colored. Mm. And then the paraphyses are really, really funny. I almost could not get a photo because they are curled up. So you cannot get them flat to see the whole thing. And they form like, it's like almost like hair, like curly hair. It's really beautiful. And as I said on this photo, they project beyond the ass cheek for some distance. I may have a photo. I think that I do, maybe. Okay, here there is the first spore. I think there are 8 spores. It was very hard to see them. They're long, like a snake, kind of like a worm. And the first spore is aligning to the tip of the ascus. I thought that was so cool. Here I found this ascus with one spore. So you can see the shape. One side is kind of rounded and the other side is pointy. And here the spore is coming out. There's only one left. Here I could, there are like the 8 spores in there. And the ascus narrows towards the bottom, towards the base.
Yeah, the picture with the several in it is really quite good. Mm-hmm. I've never seen long spores like that.
I think Hervé found this several weeks ago.
I remember, but I could not remember who found it. Yeah. Coccomyces triangularis. I think that they mentioned before that the triangularis is the shape that they produce when they burst through the bark.
Yeah. Hervé said he read that somewhere when they're very young. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. You can see some leftovers there of that.
What kind of twig was this on, do you know?
So I couldn't tell, but I look around the trees and there is tulip, poplar, maples. I was like in a swampy spot. So there were many maples, tulip, poplar, and I can't remember, but it was at the deciduous tree.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks, Marcel.
If I have time at the end, I have one Mitrula. I forgot to include that Mitrula lununatospora that I found in, and with the deformations, but different deformations this time. Oh, thank you.
Sure.
Cool, thank you.
Okay, that was it here for what I had here. And then let's see, I know Lila and Lauren both said that they had stuff. So you wanna start with us, Lila?
Sure. Yeah, this will be quick because it's the same one that Dorothy had, but I have another stage of it, I guess. All right, so here is the fungus in bloom, and it came out, I think, probably during the rain. So this is like the day after a couple of days of rain stopped. And yeah, the whole tree really was quite covered with it.
So this is this weekend?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
It's interesting that you guys are seeing this now, because this was out, you know, like what, back in April when it was cold and wet?
Yep. Mm-hmm. Well, it got pretty cold and wet.
Yeah, well, that's exactly what I was thinking. All of a sudden it was cold and wet again last week, and now we're seeing this again.
Yeah.
Oh, there's the actual goal.
Maybe we can find more else, because we went back and came back like spring.
in our dreams, I think.
But... No, somebody found more else.
Really?
Yeah. Uh-huh. Cool.
All right.
One person.
If the season is good, the morels will fruit over a period of about 3 weeks in New Jersey.
Oh.
If it's wet and can sort of rain every few days.
Mm-hmm.
And the same thing with this. This used to be almost one of my indicators in Old Wick. I used to see this a lot because there was a lot of cedar trees around Old Wick.
For morels?
No, I used to see this the cedar apple, the orange spaghetti.
Yeah, yeah.
Right out my window.
You're saying an indicator for morel hunting?
Yeah.
See, that's what I tried to ask. Okay.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, and there's others, obviously, like the bloodroot is just finished, and forsythia is done, trilliums, lilacs, apple blossoms. All those little things tell you it's time to be out looking for, and the, what's that, pink tree, it's in the pea family, Dorothy. What is that?
Red bud.
Red bud. Yeah, when that's out, the morels are out.
That's a lot of indicators, yeah.
That's right. Less to do with the human calendar, more with the botanical calendar, what the plants and things are doing.
Right. So.
That is a great picture, by the way.
Thank you.
Especially with the little, you know, whatever they are, berries.
Yeah.
Yeah, yes. They call them juniper berries, but they're not berries.
It's really a cedar, isn't it, Dorothy? A cedar tree?
No, it's a red cedar juniper. The name is juniperus. We call it Eastern red cedar, but it's not a cedar. It's a juniper.
Oh, it's a juniper. Okay.
Yep. So those are juniper berries, which really aren't berries. They're just fleshy covered seeds.
Are they the same as the juniper berries that you use as a seasoning?
Yes, that's correct. They flavor gin.
Yeah, you can also, they're very good in sauces for venison.
Yeah, that's like a traditional, like, game accompaniment, because game tastes tend to be so strong, and this holds up against that strong flavor.
Yeah, I couldn't, I took one off, and I was trying to figure out what it was at the center of it. I couldn't really tell. It was kind of just such a mess, but it seemed like it was coming out of, I thought at first, like a pine cone or something. But then I noticed these things.
They look like acorns or something, the things they burst out of.
Yeah, or pine cones or something, but it's these structures here. And so then I found them, and they seem to erupt out of these little dimples.
You can call it a gall.
You can call it a gall? Okay. Yet another gall. All right. So anyway, that was interesting, because I think, yeah, I remembered, Luke, you had shown it a few weeks back, and then it's like, oh, hey, there it is. So I was excited. But that's really all I've seen of anything of interest. Awesome.
Thanks, Lila.
Yep. Thank you.
All right, Lauren.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Hello.
You have your family photo there? Oh, that's a fake thing. Yeah, yeah.
That was in Gettysburg a bunch of years ago. Is that what you're commenting about, the family photo?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah, Gettysburg thing.
You're supposed to be what?
Well, it's supposed, we are supposed to be Civil War soldiers.
Oh, okay, okay.
Union, thanks. The right side.
The Union, of course. this week was a great week. Everything is popping in Hunterdon County. So obviously I know what this is, but just, you know, some of this is, you know, braggy stuff and some of it is, I have questions. but for those of you who eat Leptospirosis, I'm curious. So the first two that I cut off this tree were perfect. And then I left some because it was still too young. But the problem was when we went back for it, it was completely waterlogged because we went after all of that rain. So I'm wondering, for those of you who eat it, is there anything you can do with waterlogged chicken of the woods, or do you just skip?
Cook it out.
Yeah, a lot of times with chicken of the woods, I end up simmering it anyway. I like poach it and something, so.
I mean, this was really, really, really waterlogged. I mean, it was in perfect condition. It was a perfect age, but just absolutely, I mean, it was almost gross. It was almost mush.
Well, I guess you have to use your judgment, to be honest with you. I mean, yeah. If you're collecting it for food, you have to decide whether it's in an edible stage or not.
It didn't seem like it, but I thought I'd ask. Yeah, it wasn't just wet. It was gross, kind of.
If you find it like that again, leave some in situ, and the mushroom might expand and dry out a little bit on its own.
Okay, yeah, we did do that. All right. Yeah, we need to go back.
I think I would have picked it all the first I saw it, because first off, you might have other mushroom hunters who might take it from you. And the other thing is this will fill out to maturity very fast and get buggy and kind of tough.
Yeah.
So you're lucky if you find it this fresh and tender.
Take it
when you can.
Well, I took the two that you see, the one on the right and then the one kind of in the middle, but the one on the left, and then there was another one around the other side of the tree. They were really just, you know, they were just blobs, and I didn't feel like I needed to take it, as those two that I took were pretty big and gave us a lot of food. And I always find so much of this stuff anyway. But that was a fun find. That was my first chicken of the spring.
You can blanch this, can't you, and freeze it, use it later?
That's what I've heard. I've never done it yet. We always just eat it fresh or just throw it out.
Yeah, that piece right there, that's like in perfect condition, it looks.
This is the one I took and we ate.
Yeah, that one looks nice.
How did you cook it?
We had two things with it. The first thing we had was like a chicken fried rice. Mike makes it. It's absolutely delicious. Rice, egg, peas, carrots. That's really good. And then we had like a chicken parm, which was also delicious. Anyway, all right, let's see. All right, so I'm thinking these are Mycena leana. They weren't as orange as I'm used to, but they were orange, and they were, you know, tacky.
Do you have a picture of the gills underneath?
Yeah.
Was this after the rain?
And was it on cottonwood?
Oh, geez. I'm forgetting now.
Can you close up on the gills, because they should have a little bit of a reddish pink tint on the edge of the gills if the liana.
Yeah, if they got heavily rained on though, that some of those color features might get washed out. Probably what it is.
Yeah, probably is anyway though, because it is that bright of an orange.
Is there anything else that's orange, or even remotely that orange and tiny and tacky like that?
Not if it's growing on wood that I can think of.
Okay. Well, they got Gymnopolis species of orange, but they look different than this.
Yeah.
The texture is different, and the spore print is orange or rusty brown. So these are white spore print.
Yeah, these were white spore print.
Oh, that pretty much narrows it down in my mind then. Got a white spore print out of these.
Okay, let's see. Oh, this was pretty. So I'm assuming that, well, not assuming, but I'm guessing that on the right was probably Crepidotus. And then my question is about the one on the left. It didn't match entirely like what's in my book. So I'm curious what you guys think of this. This was a white spore print.
Used to be Lenzites betulina, the gilled polypore. The other
okay, that's like, that's what I was wondering.
Pinellas styptica, old from last year, probably. Oh, maybe not. Maybe it is new this year.
Did you say it's Pinellas now?
Yeah, those aren't Crepidotus. Those are probably Pinellas stypticas.
Yep.
You get a spore print out of those, it'll be white.
Oh gosh. You know what? I put them on foil and I did not get a spore print on the little ones. The big one was white.
Were they fresh?
They were, well, I think so. They seemed.
Yeah, because they can winter over.
Yeah.
What?
They can winter over and be the same fruit bodies from last year.
Yeah, and they have a very special fruit that is whitish and like hairy. You can see in the photo, the one you have it on your hands.
The little tiny stem at the base. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Talking about off.
Yep. No, that one.
Yeah, and the flesh is usually kind of resilient.
Okay.
And whereas Crepidotus mushrooms are mostly pretty fragile. They're easy to crumble.
Mm-hmm.
They're easy to tear apart.
Okay, so you think this is Pinellas
diptychus?
Yeah.
Okay. Cool.
I think so as well.
Yeah. Okay.
And usually Crepidotus are pretty generous with their spores too, and you'll get a brown spore print pretty quickly.
Okay.
If these had been fresh, they're luminescent in the if you get them into a closet, they'll glow in the dark.
Oh.
Yeah, it's a
all right. Spectrum. Okay. And you said I'm sorry, and you said the big one was called
Lenzites petulina, but is that now Trimedes or something?
It's Trimedes
now. It's Trimedes, yeah.
I saw the common name was like multicolored gilled polypore, and this one like had no. It wasn't very colorful like the ones I've seen in the book.
Probably from last year.
Yeah, which is it's got a growth of moss on top, which. When it's fresh, it wouldn't be that green on top. It would be more of a concentric of brown and white.
Now it dropped a ton of white spores. So will it do that if it's old?
That might be a strategy of another thing to compete with the rest of the world, that it, when it revives a little bit, it can drop spores that it's getting onto.
Polypores are noted for releasing their spores at varying times. That's why sometimes it's hard to get a spore print from them.
So I can't assume that because they dropped spores that they're young.
Yes.
Yeah, with polypores, I would say that holds.
Okay. All right. And then I have no idea what these were. This is a far away shot, and then I got one that's a little bit closer. I don't know if it's a plant or what.
Oh, that's some kind of a xylaria.
Yeah, nice.
Yeah.
What is a xylaria? Is that a fungus?
Yes.
Dead man's fingers is the most popular one, but this one's dead man's fingers. This is something else.
But it is a xylaria.
It's a xylaria, yeah. Yeah, I think I found this last year and got a species name, but I forget now.
Well, if you guys want to find it, it's at the Ken Lockwood Gorge, right on the trail.
Wow.
Yeah, that was really neat.
This is it. It's an Ascomycota.
You should go back and look at it in a couple of weeks and see how it's changed.
Okay. Well, it's 5 minutes away, so that's easy.
Yeah, well, it might change and hang around for a couple of months even, but change, doesn't it have a couple of life cycles, Dorothy?
Yeah, I was going to say, I think somebody told me last year that usually in the spring, they're like, these are like the anamorphic stages of them.
Yeah.
And they're very difficult to identify because the spores, you know, are not well known.
Yeah, you just get a bunch of conidia from these young ones.
Right. That's what I was told last year.
Yeah.
Nothing but conidia. You have to come back later in the year to get actual spores.
Yeah.
Or like what sexual, are conidia?
Sexual spores.
Conidia are the asexual spores, right, Dorothy?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. They're the asexual spores.
Okay, so what does that mean when you say you can only get those? Like if you do what does that mean in terms of identification or whatever?
They're hard.
Yeah, so my understanding is that a lot of these fungi will produce asexual spores at certain points of their life cycle. Basically, they're just cloning themselves. And then later on, if they have the opportunity, they'll actually have sexual reproduction with another individual from their same species and actually swap DNA and do the whole recombination thing. And then you'll get a sexual spore from them. It's the sexual spores that seem to be better for identification. The conidia, but the asexual spores are really kind of basic and difficult to use for identification.
I think most of the conidia are basically round and fairly variable in size, so you don't get much information from them.
Lauren, what you do a Google search or go to Wikipedia and look up Ascomycota, and you'll find several pages that you can read and learn about the different telomorphs and anamorphs.
Okay, we'll do that.
There you go. That's a good suggestion.
All right. I'm done. Thank you. Oh, and I just, let's see what else. Oh, yeah. So also at the same place, there's lots of Ganoderma. Yeah, this was a great week. So I found Ganoderma suge and Cereporus. Is that how you pronounce it? Cereporus squamosus?
Oh, yeah.
You chose Cereporus squamosus. I love it.
Oh, I don't have... I have pictures of it. I just didn't post them here.
Okay.
Oh, and Amanitas. I found, I think, I have.
What?
There's this house that's up the road from me. It's also my Boletus chippewyensis spot. So I'm always driving by and looking very carefully, but they have Amanita muscaria. All of the time. So I saw about three of them the other day, and I meant to get pictures for today and then just forgot. So maybe I'll try tomorrow to go and.
Wow, that's early.
Yeah, I thought so too.
All that heat.
It's probably a different Amanita, I would think, right?
No, I don't think it's muscaria.
Maybe praecox.
Yeah,
that's one of the first ones that comes out. It's yellow.
Okay, I'll get a picture of it.
Usually the universal veil on praecox doesn't form a whole lot of small white warts. It'll form several fairly large patches, if anything, on the cap.
Okay.
And it's yellow. It's really pretty bright yellow.
All right.
There's orange tint at all in praecox.
Yeah, I couldn't see from just driving by. I'll have to get out of my car and take a closer look. I just know that I found Amanita muscaria in that spot before. Right.
Do you know what kind of trees are there? Are there any hemlocks there?
Yeah.
Oh, well, there's Norway spruce there.
Yeah, that's...
I do it. Right?
There's also some things that look like praecox that come out early, and Rod Tullis thinks they're not the same. But praecox... He says it only associates with Eastern hemlock. So Even if there's just one small hemlock tree there, that could be enough though.
I found a yellow Amanita under Norway spruce, and Liz Broderick gave me the name. And I guess it was last summer. I forget what it was.
Oh, there's one that comes, that I don't get around here, that comes up like in the Pine Barrens and in southern New Jersey. I don't know that name, but there is something that I find in spruce that I don't know. I haven't really satisfactorily put a name on it. Although I had it one sequenced, and it came back as crenulata. So maybe it is. Maybe crenulata just has a highly variable morphology. So, but the first one usually is praecox. It's the spring Amanita.
Right.
Amanita muscaria complex. Even Rod hasn't sorted them all out, I don't think.
Muscaria? The muscaria is pretty well sorted out, I think.
Gesawii, right?
Yeah, Gesawii is our eastern one. I think Flavivulvata is the red one out west. Okay. And then there's muscaria, variety muscaria. I that might be the European one. I think they are sorted out, though. Oh, the only thing that's not sorted out is there actually a pure white muscaria, and is it the same or different from one of the named taxa? That Rod's not satisfied yet with the answer to that question, because he says a lot of people have sent him white muscaria. But underneath the white, if you scrape the cap, there's pigment. There's yellow, orange, or whatever pigment. So
yeah, and they will bleach out in the sun.
Yeah, they bleach out too. They lose their pigment also. So, but it's what's that name? There's a name for the pure white muscaria. It's not muscaria. It's something else. Oh, I forget. But that's the only thing that really hasn't been sorted out yet, I'm pretty sure, for the muscaria group. Praecox is in section Amanita, the same section as muscaria, but it's not considered to be a variety of muscaria. It's actually, I think praecox might be in subsection Pantherinae, or I forget how you say it, possibly, I'm not sure.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for everybody. I appreciate it.
Hey, Mary.
Oh, wait. Hey, Luke, Mike has a question. Hold on.
Hey, are you finding any golden oysters in like the Philadelphia area?
Could you hear that?
Yeah, I did hear. Am I finding any golden oysters? Not me personally, but I've seen a lot of pictures of them on Facebook.
Yeah, I've seen them a lot on Facebook. And this is the first time I've seen people actually post them in Jersey.
Eastern Penn mushroomers are, you know, sharing a lot of pictures. So Luke, has that escaped from the cultivation?
Yeah, I think it's pretty widely assumed that that's what's going on there.
Yeah, that's the conclusion that's been arrived at. They also find it now in the Midwest, Iowa, Missouri, places like that.
Have any of you found it? Anybody here?
Yeah,
I've never found it.
I see it occasionally around in my neighborhood here in Philadelphia. But to answer Mike's question, I've seen some really beautiful pictures on Facebook from like local people, you know, the Philly and the surrounding counties from the past week or so.
Somebody on our Facebook page claims that he has seen them in Hunterdon County. I go all over the place and I have not seen them, so I'm dying to find them.
They have to be, because we find them in Bucks County, and Bucks County and Hunterdon County are just separated by the river, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, they have to be there.
All right. Okay, thanks.
Sure. Thanks for sharing.
You're welcome.
Okay, that brings us up to everyone has shared who has said they wanted to share. Is there anybody else that's holding back?
Luke, if I can try a screen share, I have a good picture of the Peneophora. If nobody else is doing anything right this second, I think I've got it able to be shown. If I can figure out how to do it. Can you see that?
Yeah.
Awesome.
No, I don't know. Let's see.
Yeah, blow it up a little bit.
Yes, this is several years ago, but mine is pinker, but very distinctive. And it had to have been aspen. They're really pretty cool.
It looks like a piece of candy.
Yeah.
It really does.
Or you know, like a convoluted brain. So maybe Gary wasn't far off.
What's the name that he said?
Sorry?
What's Red? The name that he proposed?
Red brain tree fungus? Is that what it was?
Red tree brain fungus, yes.
It looks a little bit like, what is it, Ascochyrini or Ascochorny? What's that
purple
jelly thing?
What Maricel said for shriveled up red raisins or pink raisins.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. That's what I think. Yeah. That's a better description.
I know what you're saying, Dave. The Ascochorny, that does kind of look similar.
Ascochorini.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're really cool, though. And you can see this branch was covered with it, and there was more than one branch. But anyway, I thought that was the fact that I could find that quick was good.
Do you find that in Duraria?
Yes.
Oh, yep. Okay.
Smith's Vic. But it is several years ago. I don't look at the date on the picture to see what it was. Mm-hmm. I have a file. By the fact that I had it, you know, alphabetically like that, I could find it quickly.
Very nice.
Cool.
I hope to get there one day, Susan.
Well, come and see me if it's in the next few years. Yeah, it's fabulous up here. It's just horrible in the winter because I'm not a skier or a snowshoer or a really good at shoveling snow, but there is a lot of that.
I remember I lived out in Wyoming for a winter, and when I first moved out there, somebody I know that was from here in the East Coast, she told me, she said, the first thing you have to do is find a winter sport you like or you're going to go crazy.
Yeah. Well, I had been doing a lot of knitting, and there was a group that got together for knitting, but of course with COVID, that stopped. For some reason, my motivation sort of dried up too, but because I had done the mushroom dyeing, I couldn't justify buying more wool unless I knit something up that was either useful or I could sell or otherwise. So that's why I've made a lot of sweaters and hats. But I haven't done much knitting lately. My hands are stiffening up, but we'll see. But I always like to collect the mushrooms regardless. So it's like I say, all those boxes are mushrooms back there for dyeing.
Yeah. Nice. All right. Is there anybody else that wants to share? I saw Lauren had one more.
Yeah, Lauren has another one.
Anybody else before we start winding down?
I might be able to try to figure out how to share on my phone, but if it doesn't work, it doesn't work.
All right. You want to show us your last one, Lauren, and then let Bianca go?
Sure.
Or vice versa, whichever.
Found these in growing in my grass today. How do I get rid of this? Hold on, Mike's gotta help me.
Your screen looks fine. There's nothing.
Nah, I just got the video in the arrow area, so.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
LBM.
Panioloas. Fenesquiae.
Well, Fenesquiae. Yeah, if you take a spore print take it on black. Find a pure black glossy surface that's not going to absorb moisture. And if the print is so black that you can't really see it against the black background, then it's something other than Panaeolus foenosecchiae. If it's Panaeolus foenosecchiae, which is a pretty likely ID here, it will have a very slight purple tinge to the spore. And you need a pretty thick spore print too to see that. So there'll be this slight contrast with the black that will be dark, dark purplish. It's probably what it is. The spores too, if you can scope spores, there's a feature to the spores, I forget. I think they might be textured rather than smooth, or it might be the other way around. That's probably what that is though. Panaeolus foenosecchiae. It's a lawn mushroom. It starts in mid-spring usually.
Okay. The caps were kind of greeny, and I'm wondering, like, can you see how there's like, they're kind of dirty? I'm wondering, is that just, is that a characteristic, or if that was just like an accident that stuff, debris fell on the caps?
I don't know. They look kind of tan, beige, brown to me. And pretty much that's the color.
Dave, if you zoom in, there's actually some white flecks on it. So it could be potentially.
Oh, the white flecks.
Yeah.
Oh, like I see those white flecks. I don't know what that is.
I wonder if I just picked up crap off the table.
Yeah, I don't I don't think Panaeolus foenosecchiae has any kind of anything like a universal veil. So, but it could be something else, you know.
They look a little older, which just means that there may be some kind of not a mold, but what am I trying to think of?
It might be pollen.
Yeah, something else that's just dropped on it.
Okay.
Starting to help break it down. But, you know, if it's an LBM, I wouldn't worry an awful lot about identification.
No, I know. It's just fun to see what you guys come up with.
Yeah, if it's Panaeolus foenosecchiae, yeah, you can nail the ID.
Okay.
Yeah, with the spore print color and but you'd have to scope the spores too, to really, you know, really.
Yeah, but then you have to have something to look at the spores against. I mean, as far as a reference guide. And that's why I have a lot of books, but I don't have ones that show spores for every species.
Yeah, you can find pictures online. There's actually a lot of Panaeolus pictures online because there's a certain subculture of mycology that gravitates towards Panaeolus.
Towards things that are hallucinogenic?
Yes. And foenosecchiae apparently is not one of the favored species. It does contain some sort of psychoactive substance, but in such small amounts, you'd have to eat like 100 of them or something, and that would just probably make you sick. Actually, there's been a few instances where children grazing in the yard have eaten these things, and I think in one case, a young child, like a 2 or 3 year old, ended up in the ER and was pretty sick. And they think it was Panaeolus foenosecchiae because that's what was in the yard. It's probably what these are.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Cool. Thanks. All right, Bianca, you going to try it? Good night, Dorothy.
Yeah, I'm going to try. Let's see how it goes. All right. So I want to do photo. Allow photos. Okay. How much are you guys seeing all the different photos or any of it? I'll select a photo, or let me see if this.
Not seeing anything.
Nothing
so
yet.
Far.
Okay. How about now? You see a stump?
There we go.
Down log. Great.
Down log, yes.
All right, so there's two of them here. This is a general view. Obviously, I couldn't really pick out what it was. So there's one closer in and one at the base of the other tree.
Oh, so I see. Over.
Yeah, looks like an old Pluteus.
Yeah.
Right.
So looks like Pluteus cervinus.
Yeah.
All right. Oh, it doesn't let me. I literally have to share each photo. Oh, gosh. Okay. Well, let's try again. So I'm going to do the zoom in, which is, oh, heaven. Photos. All right. So the zoom in is this guy. That's the cap. And I'm gonna have to stop. This is such a shame. I have to stop sharing each time in order to get to the next photo. Sorry about that. All right, stopping.
You know, when I prepare for Taxonomy Tuesday, I actually make a little file that I draw from before I send the pictures to Luke.
So I normally do too. It's just that I left my laptop at work, and so all of my photos are there. There you go.
Free gills, Pluteus cervinus.
And they're also a little pinkish.
Yeah, a little pinkish.
From the photo, yeah, I would say it looked more kind of like a light tan, but if you're calling this pinkish, that makes
sense. But if you put this down on a piece of white paper, it's going to drop a lot of spores, and they call that salmon pink.
Ah, okay. All right. Let me then go back to sharing. So if you don't mind putting that in the text, I'll try to. I don't know how I'm going to get it, honestly. I'll figure it out, I guess. All right. So then that was one. Number two is this guy. Can you see this one?
Mm-hmm.
Pluteus. I just got it. Okay. So that is the top. I'm going to have to stop again. Photo. Camera. So now the underside looks like this.
Same thing.
I think it's another Pluteus.
Oh, really? Okay, interesting. So the Pluteus, a younger one, almost has a little, kind of like a black dot at the top?
Maybe, you know.
Well, a darker center.
I wouldn't say that's a characteristic to count on.
Okay.
The cap surface can vary a little in color.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Okay.
It's the free gills, really, that grayish, brownish cap, fairly good sized mushroom and gills that do not reach the stalk, and sometimes it's hard to tell because gills can sometimes pull away from the stalk and then they look like they're free. So you might find that on an enteloma, for instance, and then it's a little bit confusing. I can't really see on this picture though. Are those gills, are they reaching the stalk?
So just the white fibrous material that's between the gills and the cap surface skin, that's what's touching the stalk, but the gills themselves are not.
Oh, I see. I see. Yes, that's cap context that's actually breaking away from the stalk. The gills themselves are rounded, and the rounded end of the gill comes up a few millimeters short of the stalk. Yeah, that's Pluteus.
Okay, great. Pretty cool that I got two of them, two different areas. Well, same park, but two different spots. All right.
It likes whatever the weather was this past week.
I guess so. And one more, and I'm hoping to stump you. it was attached. This is the top of it that I had seen, just like this, with that tiny little bit of yellow poking out. And I kind of started poking at it to see if it would detach. It did. And a bunch of, as you can see, critters came with it. And so this is the top, and I'm going to share the inside in a second.
this. Quite vibrant yellow, almost looks like cornbread with bugs in it.
Gosh, I don't know.
I'm sure it's quite old, whatever it is.
Yeah, I was going to say, this almost looks like a hypomyces on some old bolete, but a little early for boletes.
I couldn't call it a bolete. I couldn't. It literally was, the texture was not quite spongy, but almost like a sponge that was very old and had just been microwaved.
Well, yeah, but boletes tend to be very fleshy, and if it's rain, you know, if you've had a lot of rain, they go to mush very quickly, and a number of things will attack them to break them down.
Ah,
it looks like
Susan, you don't think this is Fiala Schwenice, huh?
No, it doesn't look right at all for that.
Well, it's been around, so. I think it's a power pore of some kind.
Well, if it is, I don't know what it would be. Can you zoom in on that to see what if it's got pores?
Well, it's hard to tell whether this yellow was kind of attached to that spot. So it was, the brown was on top. It does look like it has kind of a root. It's really hard to tell.
Yeah. I can't really tell. Maybe if we, yeah, see.
You can't. How big was it?
Let's see. Did I take a, with my hand, usually I try to do that. It was about the size, if you put your finger to your thumb, about the size of the outside of that, of your finger to thumb circumference.
So it's about 3 to 4 inches?
Yes, that sounds right. So this again will be the, where'd it go? This one. Oh, I didn't, well, you can see the bugs for size comparison. Yeah.
I can't tell what that is at all.
For a fresher specimen, maybe.
Yeah, I'm sorry. It was just so vibrant of a yellow. I thought maybe it might have been something that you guys knew that was just super vibrant even when it was decomposing. That's all right.
Maybe a really old Onia tomentosa. Does that make any sense to anybody?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. With the thing that it doesn't usually have that long of a stem.
Yeah, well, was it growing up on the wood or not the base?
So this, right where this outline is exactly where I pulled it off from.
Oh, right on the grain of the wood. Yeah, that's yes. Not only a tomentosa then.
But it could have decomposed and kind of stuck to it. So
Sue said, it's probably like some sort of hypomyces or something on something, like an old polypore.
Yeah.
Makes sense. All right, I don't think I have any more. I'm gonna double check right now.
Well, you stumped everybody.
Yeah, but you know, I have to say, much as we're all excited about fungi, there is a limit as what is identifiable.
Oh, I do have one.
Spend a lot of time on something that you can't even see any of the features that you need for identification is you know, not a good use of your time.
Sure. It was just so interesting how vibrant it was.
Well, right, but Sam Ristich isn't alive anymore, but he would love that sort of thing and tell you all about it. But
aww. So I've seen the hairy version of this in that lime green color, but I have never seen this with almost like a creamy orange creamsicle color.
Can you zoom in on it?
The parasite.
Oh, the orange is the parasite.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay.
I just can't remember the name. Gary Taylor, he knows.
Yeah, and Dorothy just signed off. She's a lichen person.
But then
darn.
Didn't Garrett one time say too that it's not always a parasite? Sometimes it's the cortex.
Oh.
That oh. The outside of it's been like worn away, and now you're looking at the cortex.
Oh, I don't know about that. Oh, if it's the parasite, there are two. And if it's what you're saying, yeah, I don't know.
Okay. Okay. That's good to know that there's it's either a parasite or potentially the fact that it's worn away. Okay. All right. And I think I have one more photo of that. Let me see if I can grab it.
You put that photo in, do you do iNaturalist?
No, I don't really do any of that
okay.
yet.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I feel like I'm not good enough yet to know to put that on.
No, but it's not that you're good or not. That's how you start learning things.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Or giving you ideas, and then you look for those and see if it matches or not. Yeah. Sure.
Yeah. And that's all I have.
All right, cool. Thanks, Bianca.
Thank you very much.
All right, so before we wrap up, I just found out about this just at the beginning of this, beginning of our meeting today, that Coma just announced today or maybe yesterday that they're open and the registration is open. So for anybody who's interested in this foray up in Connecticut, it's a really good foray. I've only been there once, but it's very well regarded by other people in our club.
Yeah, it's really good. I've already sent my money, and Dorothy too, today.
Yep. So Labor Day weekend. I just put the this link in our chat. So if anybody is interested in that. So that's pretty exciting news.
Alan and Arlene Bissette, Jack Blischke, Roz Lowen, Leon Sharnoff, Bill Yule, Diana Smith, and it's just south of Hartford, southeast of Hartford, easy to get to. It's a Easter Seals place that it's a funny building, but it's perfect for what we need to do. And one of the other good things is that it's small. It's maybe 70 people at max. So it probably will fill up quickly. It's informal, good collecting sites with carpooling, food and lodging all included. I want to say the bathrooms are a little crude, but not unacceptable. But everything's in one building. Plus it has a swimming pool.
Oh, nice.
Yeah,
I was wondering, I couldn't find the price when I clicked on it. Of course, on my phone, I can't do very well. Does it say how much it is?
With the food and lodging is $340 per person. Options Friday to Monday is that one, or Friday to Sunday, Saturday to Monday, or even just a single day, and they're all priced out. So take a look at it if you're interested. I have to say that if you're wanting to learn and have a lot of people around you talking about mushrooms, just to listen, this is a definite good opportunity because it's not intimidating. It's not like the huge forays with hundreds of people. This is a more informal discussion all of the time with everybody and whoever's standing next to you. So you learn a lot. And they identify the stuff and record it. Paula DeSanto, I think, is probably their recorder. And then they lay out, you know, like the Northeast, but in Boley table, Amanitas, Russula, Lactarius. So you can sit there and look at them as much as you want, but also you can get a lot of help with when you're unloading your basket and sorting them out and identification and what have you.
Excuse me. Does anybody have any plans to go to any of the Colorado events? The NAMA foray?
NAMA foray? No, too far for me. I don't like flying. But okay. That's another one that's larger scale, but Sam Landis will probably put a lot of good things together for a big foray. That's usually at a ski resort or something.
Yeah, exactly.
Fabulous event to learn with probably a lot of good mycologists, both amateur and probably a few professionals. I recommend it if you can do any of those.
Okay. I'll make my fiance go for my birthday weekend.
Which one?
For the Connecticut.
Yeah, start small and go to Connecticut. Yeah. Oh, and they have a fabulous mycophagy session. Just a whole array of all kinds of prepared dishes and all kinds of mushrooms. A lot of them are from the city, and that they are definitely foodies and want good food. Not necessarily, the place is mediocre to sort of okay, but passable. Whereas their private mycophagy, which is included in the price, is really excellent.
I think you just sold me just with that.
Well, Luke, you said you've been once. Do you remember?
Oh yeah, it was great. I just went up there a few years ago for one of them, and they're great.
Yeah, I particularly like the facility because it's everything in one building. It's a funny shape, horseshoe shaped building, but you don't have to go across a football field back to your room to change, and you know, it's compact, and I don't know how to describe it, but anyway, I like going, and you can learn a lot.
All right, well, I think that's about bringing us up to almost 9 o'clock. So I want to thank everyone for sharing and joining us tonight. And I guess get out there and get some pictures for next week, right?
Okay.
All right.
Thank you everyone so much.
Thank you. Good night. Good night.
Right. Well, everyone have a great night. And see you next week.
Bye-bye.
Those cards are really good.